The Extended Producer Responsibility Act lapsed into law in the Philippines in July last year. It requires large enterprises to recover a certain portion of their plastic packaging waste every year or else pay a fine. Now, the Environment Department is looking to include the informal waste sector in the mix to improve waste collection systems as the country slowly shifts to a circular economy. Let's discuss this with Rose Liza Aisma Osorio, Acting Vice President of Oceana Philippines. Hi, good afternoon, attorney, and thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon, Rica. Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure, attorney. Let's talk about this Extended Producer Responsibility Act, or EPRA, of 2020. It mandates large companies to implement policies for proper waste management, especially of plastic products. Since the IRR has been released, have we seen the supposed effects of this law?
Not yet, because in fact, the Environment Department reported that only 15% of the covered companies have in fact registered under the EPR scheme, which they are required to do within 6 months of the effectivity of the law. So if you say that the law became effective on July 2022, it's supposed to be 100% already by the time, you know, January 2023 came around. But then, as we all know, only 50%, which is 600 out of the 4,000 companies that are supposed to register under the EPR law, has registered so far. So it's very, very slow in terms of, you know, its implementation.
Mm-hmm. When we say we only have 600 out of the 4,000, these 4,000, they were identified by the government, right? But is the registration mandatory?
Yes, it's mandatory. So for them not to register, they are also subject to penalties, as mentioned in the law itself. So it's the same as not implementing the EPR scheme as well. So both of this should be mandatory on their part. And even if the law has certain shortcomings, because it only covers large enterprises, and we think that, you know, we prefer to have this law cover all categories, all enterprises, for this to be effective. However, you know, the law itself has certain limitations because it only covers large companies or those with 1 billion assets.
Mm-hmm. And with what you said, this actually is an alarming concept. If we only get just the big companies, because the Philippines, no matter how small a nation we are, is the third most producer of plastic waste in the whole world. So the implementation itself, we're seeing that this is having a big problem. Let's talk about the fines, attorney, of the law. If we see a company violating this or even not registering, what does the law say that the fines are supposed to have?
The law says that they could be subject to 5 million to 10 million pesos for the first offense, and it increases for the second offense, 10 to 15 million, and in the third offense, 15 to 20 million pesos.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's quite a big amount for a company to pay. But the implementation itself is also an issue. Let's say, attorney, that the company is a supplier of plastic products. How do we handle after sales to the customer supplier and the relationship? How does it work when it comes to waste management?
Once they register their EPR program, they also have to include, you know, the programs that they will adopt, such as a buyback mechanism. So they can say, you know, they will buy back the plastics that they are selling to the consumers, or put up waste collection systems in at certain points. So they are basically required or responsible for getting back the waste that they are producing. And so these are mechanisms that's supposed to be in place already or starting to be in place, because at the end of this year, these large enterprises are supposed to take back 20% of the waste that they are producing.
Mm-hmm. But the EPRA law, attorney, covers only plastic waste. The EPRA law covers plastic waste that are being used by large companies. Does it also cover internal company policies?
Yes. So this internal policies of the enterprises that are registered should also abide by the EPR schemes that they submit to the government in terms of once they register. So they're bound to follow, they're bound to implement the EPRA schemes that they're supposed to commit to.
Mm-hmm. But there are only 600 companies who registered out of the 4,000 that we're supposed to have. So those 600 is a small number, and it wouldn't even make a big chunk when we talk about pollution in the Philippines. Now, the DNR has a full plate. The waste management itself is a big problem. Segregation is a problem. Recycling is a problem, and especially on plastic pollution. Why does it feel like this is being placed in the back burner? The issues just kept getting worse.
Yes. We produce about 600 metric tons, and 12% of that is our plastics. And so it's quite clear that we cannot handle the mounting plastic pollution that we have. And the oceans are being affected because of the plastic leakage into our oceans, because we have poor waste management facilities as well as poor management practices that are in place. And so that's why, as advocate for the oceans and for the environment, we prefer a nationwide ban or phase out of single-use plastics. So we should stop just producing these plastics that are unnecessary, that are single-use, and so that we can manage, whatever is already not, out there, and stop already producing what we cannot manage clearly.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Let's go now to the government asking the informal waste collection sector for help on this one. We have a lack of recycling companies in the country. There's also the waste management program that the government should look at, because we're not accepting incineration as a means of waste management. What we have are dump sites that just collect more waste. It just is bad for the environment. What do you think we should do when and how the informal waste collection system can help with this?
Unfortunately, the informal waste collection systems, if you look at the letter of the law, they're not covered by the EPRA. Mm-hmm. And so it's clearly they cannot be compelled by the government, but just to be, they can be asked, it could be suggested on them. But they also play a very crucial role when it comes to the Solid Waste Management Act, or RA 9003, because everyone is covered by that law, where we have to have good solid waste management practices. But it's clear that recycling only contributes about 12% in terms of us being able to manage our waste. That's why the problem goes back then to how much more could we produce plastic waste when we cannot even manage, when we cannot even recycle those. As you said earlier, we don't have those, recycling facilities that are in place in other countries for us to be able to manage our waste. And we cannot also advocate for incineration, which we are very concerned of, because of the air pollution, the toxic air pollution that it would produce, and it might create more widespread effect on the human population.
Mm-hmm. We are seeing a lot of issues on the EPRA law, maybe primarily because this was just lapsed into law and wasn't really discussed very thorough in the Congress. Mm-hmm. Do you think, attorney, that the EPRA law should be discussed and reviewed again by the Congress to at least see what else we can do to beef this up?
Yeah. In fact, our call, together with the Break Free from Plastics group, which we are part of, was for Marcos, President Marcos, to veto the bill, because there clearly wasn't any extensive discussion and thinking through of how this law would be implemented and how this law would become effective in addressing our plastic waste, our solid waste pollution. So it's really important to revisit, to review this law, and maybe improve on how we're going to look at this extended producer responsibility law would cover not only large enterprises, but also, the small, medium scale enterprises. Because again, it's clearly the problem entails a whole of the nation approach. It's not only for one or two entities. It should be for everyone involved.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've spoken with Oceana and a lot of international companies as well when it comes to green energy, when it comes to environment concerns. Mm-hmm. And all of those I've been able to interview are saying that, yes, there is knowledge, enough knowledge for the people to have an idea of what they should do, but the technology is not there. Do you think that the government should also have at least some talks with international players to increase our waste management system?
Yeah, clearly, we have a very good law in place, the solid waste management law for waste management. And the responsibility to implement it falls largely on our local government units under the law. Of course, it should be, guided by the National Solid Waste Management Commission. But I think, if we are only intent on becoming more effective in addressing our solid waste and mm-hmm. plastic waste pollution mm-hmm. issues, we could ask, help from other entities to improve our technologies, to improve the way we manage it. Or we could learn from already existing practices because, the ban on single-use plastics has already been implemented by some cities on their own, mm-hmm. We could learn from each other, especially those local government units that are lagging behind in terms of implementing, and managing their solid waste pollution.
Mm-hmm. I do know that Quezon City has, I think, a ban on the single-use plastic, if I'm not mistaken. So this is a fight mm-hmm. that we cannot lose, attorney. And there's a lot more that the government can offer. We just need to talk this out. And with that, I will let you go. Thank you so much for your time, attorney, and hoping for more fruitful discussions with you in the future.
Thank you so much, Rica.
Thank you. That's Attorney Rose Eliza Aisma Osorio of Oceana joining us.